Hello. Well, today it's block schedule, and so it's a longer schedule. We've got about an hour and a half in class, and what I'd like to remind you of is that if there's any work that you haven't done on from previous assignments, then you have an opportunity to get those done today in class after the video lecture. So we move forward, but you may need to go back and complete assignments that have not been done. So with that in mind, remember that on the school website, you will find my website, and I have posted up solutions to the assignments. You just have to go to the geometry folder and download the document, print the document out, and use it to complete your assignment if necessary, or if you just want to verify that what you did is correct. So today we're going to be discussing a couple of concepts. We're going to talk about rectangles, squares, trapezoids, and kites. So it's a busy, busy day. It's a block schedule. And so let's move forward here. So we all know what a rectangle is, right? And a rectangle is just a four-sided shape, a quadrilateral, that has four right angles. Opposite sides are congruent. Opposite angles are congruent. Diagonals bisect each other, and so on and so forth. So, looking at our activity sheet, we also know that there are special properties of rectangles, and I've listed those there. It's a parallelogram, so all those properties of parallelograms hold true for rectangles. So, I'd like to just slide on through here and look at what I have in the packet and talk about it. So, we've got the rectangle here. It says that a rectangle is a rectangle if and only if the diagonals are congruent. And so that being said, if I have diagonals that are congruent, then it's enough to show that the quadrilateral is a rectangle. And that's a good thing to know. So, two things we've just talked about. Four right angles and looks like diagonals are congruent. Let's use some of these properties and see if we can figure out whether these statements below 9 through 14 are sometimes or always true. Now remember, I'm expecting every single question to be done out of this packet, so don't skip anything. So, let's copy and paste and make this happen. So let's draw my rectangle. Now again, a rectangle is a parallelogram with four right angles. So there's my rectangle with four right angles. This is also a rectangle. Try to draw a square. Okay, so let's pretend that is a square. So, again, those meets the condition of a rectangle. It's a parallelogram. Opposite sides are parallel and four right angles. So, a rectangle is a rectangle where opposite sides are congruent. And the square is a rectangle. Right? Just so happens that we've got the four right angles, but all four sides are congruent. So, let's label this W, X, Y, Z. And this is also W, X, Y, Z. Let's talk. For any rectangle, decide whether the statement is always or sometimes true. Draw a diagram and explain your reasoning. Angle W is congruent to angle X. W is congruent to X. Always true, since all four angles are right. Always true. Side WX or segment WX is congruent to segment YZ. Opposite sides are congruent since it's a parallelogram. It's always true. 11, WX is congruent to XY. Now, this is the tricky part. That is sometimes true, and here's why. Here, obviously, they're not. Different lengths, right? But with a square, they are. That's sometimes true. Okay, WY is congruent to XZ. Those are diagonals, which is what we're looking at here. And it's true that the diagonals are always congruent. Always true. WY is perpendicular to XZ. And that's sometimes true. It's only true for squares. Check this out. See, I'm a little off of my diagram, but that does look like a 90-degree angle. See that? This doesn't. That looks like it's obtuse. This looks acute. So this is sometimes true. And then angle WXZ, WXZ is congruent to angle YXZ. Ooh, WXZ and Y. So where is that at? Let's find this. There's WXZ and W and YXZ. Now, this appears to not be true, and it is not true. They don't bisect the angles. And I can look at my information, and it shows that under activity 2 for rectangles, it says nothing about the diagonals bisecting the opposite angles. So it's not the case. So it does happen, though, when you are given a square. These angles are bisected, okay? So this is sometimes true. All righty, good stuff. Moving on. So, again, we're on page 25, properties of rectangles, and so it says classify this special quadrilateral, explain your reasoning, then find the values of X and Y. So if you have four right angles, then you've got a rectangle. You can show that the opposite sides are all congruent. If you have four congruent sides, then it would be a square. But I think it's safe to say that 27 and number 6 are all rectangles. And now you're solved for X and Y. So I'm just going to set this up for you, but you know that the opposite sides are congruent. And so set up equations that solve for X and Y, okay? Here, we're not solving for X and Y. There's not enough information, so we're not able to do that, okay? But I'd like you to explain your reasoning why you know this is a rectangle. And hint, explain that you have four right angles and that it's a parallelogram, too. 38 through 43. Let's copy and paste that. Check that out. That didn't work. Let's try it again. Oh, yeah, it did. It didn't copy on a new page, did it? There we go. That's better. So, we're going to enlarge the original diagram for clarity here. Let's see. Enlarge that. There we go. Nice. All right. Now, rectangle. The diagonals of rectangle QRST intersect at P. Given that the measure of angle PTS is 34 degrees, and QS is 10. Find the indicated measures. Now, so I'm just going to go ahead and fill this out myself. I know that this is 34 degrees. I also know this is 34 degrees. Alternate interior angles are congruent when you have parallel lines cut by a transversal. Okay. We know that the diagonals are congruent, right? And so we also know that these segments are congruent, and so are these segments. Alrighty? Vertical angles are congruent. Yes, yes, yes. We know that too. And so we can there we go. And so we can also make a claim. I think about a lot of different things. Let's just go with this here. So SRT. What is the measure of that angle? So SRT. Well, we know that we have 90 degrees, right? Right angles. So if this is 34, if you take 90, subtract 34, end up with 56. So this has to be 56 degrees here. And there you are. SRT is 56 degrees. Let's keep moving forward. What about QRP? QPR. Minus a QPR. Well, QPR, let's see if we can analyze this too as well. I think it's safe to say that we know a couple of things about this this triangle here at the top. That is, it looks like an isosceles triangle. In other words, the base angles have to be congruent, since the legs are congruent. So I'm going to just mention that these legs are congruent. See them? So if the base angle here is 34, then this angle here must also be 34. And that allows me to find this angle here, which is QPR, this angle right here. I'll highlight it, okay, in yellow, this angle right there. And so we know that the sum of the angles is 180 degrees for any triangle. So we're given two angles out of the three, so we can find the missing third angle. So 34 plus 34 is 68. If you take 180, subtract 68. That would be 112 degrees here. Now you get the idea on how to do this, guys, so I'm going to have you do the rest, 40, 41, 42, 43. Moving on. Properties of squares. Okay, and I've added some information here that's pretty vital, and that is that squares are quadrilaterals, four-sided polygons, right? They have four sides congruent and four angles congruent. Only way that could happen is if the four angles are 90 degrees. And so, that's what we have so far. So a square is a parallelogram with four congruent sides and four right angles. So there we go. Now let's see if we can use this information to solve some questions about squares. Here's an interesting question. Okay. Classify the special quadrilateral. It's a square. Explain your reasoning, then find the values of x and y. Now, how do I know it's a square? Well, I've got to show, number one, that all four sides are congruent. And I can do that. Look closely here. We have 90 degrees here, right? 90 degrees. And so I can explain pretty quickly that these angles are all 90 degrees, right? And then I can go on and say to myself that, hey, we know it's got to be at least a rectangle, four right angles, but since the diagonals are perpendicular and they bisect each other, then you can show that the triangles are congruent, all four, by side angle side. And I'm looking at our activity sheet, activity four, if I'm not mistaken. We did that, and so all of the triangles are congruent. Hence, the sides are also all congruent. So four right angles, four congruent sides. It is a square. Now, I'd like you to explain that. Use your activity sheet when explaining that. So, let's find the values of x and y. All right. Now, the value of y. Diagonals bisect each other, so they're equal to each other. Oh, isn't too difficult. Okay. And the value of x, well, it's not too bad either. It's like we have that 3x plus 18 is 90 degrees. Okay, let's see how that turns out. Okay, and now what I'm assuming here, and this is an assumption of mine, and I think it's correct. I am assuming that 5x, I'm thinking that, is that the value, is that value equal to 90? Let's see. That would be 18, huh? Now, the problem I have with this question is that, hey, I found x, but I'm not 100% convinced that that's the proper answer. Because is 5x equal to this small angle here, which would be 45 degrees, or 90? So I'm assuming it's 90. Now, the error could also be made here, that I'm pointing here at this angle, which is 45 degrees. So it could be that 3x plus 18 equals 45 degrees. And subtracting 18 from 45, I get 3x equals, that would be, let's see, 20, 38, 27. So x would be 9. So that may be the right answer. Who knows? I think that is the case here in part because if I look closely now, well, yeah, both cases don't seem right. Yeah, and that's one of the tragedies. I see it now. I think we're saying that 5x is this value here. It's the angle being bisected. So So that's 45 degrees. And I see it here too as well, 3x plus 18. That has to be 45 degrees. So yeah, they're not equal to 90, they're equal to 45. So that would be the wrong case, this is right. And here, 5x would be 45 degrees. And so solving that also gives me 9. So with that being said, hey, sometimes, you know, a question is misleading because it's not clear in the way it's presented. I'll go ahead and attempt to answer 44 through 49. Okay, give it a shot, do the best you can. And I'd like you to classify this quadrilateral. Explain your reasoning again. Think about the side angle side pattern. Explain that those triangles are congruent, all four, and that by corresponding parts of congruent figures are congruent, CPCTC, that the opposite sides are all congruent. Now, let's look at the properties of trapezoids and kites. Properties of trapezoids and kites. So, trapezoids and kites. Now, we've talked a little bit about trapezoids and kites on our activity portfolio packet, but there's some information here that we had not talked about, and that is the idea of the mid-segment theorem. And it's in your I printed out that worksheet that had that information, but I never really formally introduced it. So you'll be seeing that introduced today. And it's called the mid-segment theorem for trapezoids. And it's found at the bottom of that worksheet on the left-hand side. So I'm just warning you. So, first of all, what is a trapezoid? It's a four-sided shape, quadrilateral, with exactly one pair of parallel sides. The parallel sides are the bases, and we mentioned that. Angles A and D are called base angles. This information here. These would be base angles. Okay? Angles B and C are also base angles. These are also base angles here. And they don't necessarily all have to be congruent. Matter of fact, they're not. They have to be supplementary. Okay? Now, here's a special type of trapezoid. It's called the isosceles trapezoid. It's a lot like the isosceles triangle. And that is that the legs are congruent. The legs are congruent. And so if you have a trapezoid with congruent legs, then that guarantees that your base angles are also congruent. Good stuff. Now, let's jump right in. Okay. Now, we are given, it's like a trapezoid of some sort. And I'm going to assume that the trapezoid appears to be isosceles. Okay? I'm going to assume that the trapezoid appears to be isosceles. So what that means is that these two legs are congruent. So there are a bunch of triangles that are constructed when diagonals are drawn in a isosceles trapezoid. And so what you end up doing is you end up showing that these triangles are in fact congruent, and by corresponding parts you can show that the certain segments are congruent to each other. Base angles are congruent as well, since it's an isosceles trapezoid. There's ways of showing that certain items are congruent. And so without showing the formal proof, what I can see visually is this, is that this triangle here an isosceles triangle. So that guarantees that this segment here is congruent to this segment there. And so that would be 3x equals 21. And solving that, we get x equals 7. Okay? I can also see visually, since this is an isosceles trapezoid, that we have another triangle. Looks like it's an isosceles triangle. And again, without going through the formal proof, I can show that these are in fact congruent. And so 5x plus 2 is equal to 6x minus 5. Subtracting 5, you'll get x. Adding 5, you get 7. Okay, good stuff. Now, we have not talked about the mid-segment theorem for trapezoids, so I'm going to introduce it with an example here. So I'm going to draw a trapezoid. Here's my trapezoid. I'm going to draw two parallel lines. Okay. I'm going to connect the endpoints here. Let's try that again. Not perfect, but close enough. So these are parallel. Alright, so here's the mid-segment theorem. Let's come up with some numbers. Let's call this 10, and then we'll call this 8. Okay, the bases. Alright, 10 and 8. Now, I'm going to find the midpoint of each leg. Oh, that's not good enough. Try it again. Thinking right there, maybe. I'm thinking right here. So those are the midpoints of each leg. So I've cut this segment to congruent pieces. Sound good? Now what the mid-segment theorem says of trapezoids is this, that if you connect the midpoints, you connect these midpoints, the length of the midpoint, is 9. Wow. What I'm saying is, essentially, what number is between the number 8 and 10? What's right smack in the middle? Well, it's 9. In other words, it's similar to finding the average of two given numbers. Again, these numbers have to be the length of your base. Okay. And so the theorem says that the mid-segment is the sum of the bases divided by 2. So that would be 18 times a half, which is 9. The formal theorem would look something like this. If I was to remove the variables and come up with a generic formula, here's what it would look like. I'll call this A, B, and C. So the length of C is equal to half the sum of A plus B. Alrighty? That's how you find the length of C. So remember that. Keep it in mind. And we'll use it right now. And find the length of certain segments. Okay. So I'm going to use that formula that I just generated to solve some questions here. So, let's go to question number 3. Find the value of x using the mid-segment theorem. Now again, that is a trapezoid. Just think about it. It's written another way. It's written horizontally, so no big deal. So I'm going to think about my formula. It says that the C equals 1 half A plus B, the average of the two bases. So I call this A, call this B, call the middle C. So let's plug it in. So we end up with 18 is half of the sum of the bases, which is x plus 3x. Okay, we're solving for x, remember. So this would be 4x times a half equals 18. I'm going to get rid of this half. I'm not. I'm going to work it out. Work the half. Just work it out. So half goes into 4. Divide by 2. X equals 9. Isn't that coincidental? Isn't that what I got on my previous question? Yeah. Good stuff. Moving on, moving on, moving on. Now we're going to talk about kites. And again, this I'm kind of all over the map a little bit here. So let's see if I have any diagrams of kites. No, I don't. So I don't have any diagrams of kites. So I'm going back to my my theorem worksheet, and again, it's on the website. If you don't have it, download it, check it out. But there are properties of kites that are very, very important. And looking at these properties, we know that only one pair of opposite angles are congruent. And then we also know that only one diagonal is a perpendicular bisector of the other, and that consecutive sides are congruent, but opposite sides are not. And so what I have here is I have a kite, and the measures of the angles are 6x, 24, 84, and 126. Find the value of x. What are the measures of the angles that are congruent? So that seems like a very, very demanding question. It may have been a bonus question. So I'm going to attempt this just by remembering one single property, and that is that a kite is a quadrilateral, and that the sum of the angles, interior angles in any quadrilateral is 360 degrees. So given that fact, I'm going to use that. I'm going to tell myself, okay, I've got a kite. It's got four interior angles. And again, if you don't remember what a kite looks like, look at activity 5. And on that particular activity, you drew one out. Okay. Check out that kite. It's got these four angles. And so the sum of the angles, interior angles, is 360. So right, the first angle is 6x. Second angle is 24. Third angle is 84. And the final angle is 126. The sum of those four angles is 360. So using a calculator or long math, I can see that 24 plus 84 is 108. 108 plus 126 is 234. So I'm going to subtract 234 from 360. 126. So I end up with 6x equals 126. Now, this is interesting here because I'm going to stop there because I've noticed something right here. Look, 6x is 126. 6x, that is 126. So my four angles, here they are. They're 126. The other angle is 24. See it? Just copying these down. 84 degrees. And the other one is 126. So what are the measures of the angles that are congruent? 126. Okay? And if you find the value of x, you're just dividing 126 by 6, and that would be 21, right? So the value of x was 21. But again, Yeah, interesting question. Kind of weird. Okay, moving on. I'm going to skip some of these questions and go straight into these questions here. Okay, tell whether a statement is always, sometimes, or never true. Okay, a trapezoid is a parallelogram. Think about what it looks like, trapezoid. Something like this. Parallel sides. That's a trapezoid, right? One pair of parallel sides. Is it a parallelogram? No, you'd have to have both pairs of opposite sides being parallel. So that's never true. It's never true. The bases of a trapezoid are parallel. That's always true. The base angles of an isosceles trapezoid are congruent. That's always true. The legs of a trapezoid are congruent. That's sometimes true. If the trapezoid itself is a isosceles, the legs are congruent. If it's not isosceles, the legs aren't congruent. Now, look at this kite. Let's find some angle measures here. Again, an interesting property of kites is that you've got one diagonal that's bisected, right? So let's try one question. Let's work on this one here. Let's look at 14. Let's find the value of k. So I can do that. Let's find the value of k. So we're trying to find the measure of angle k. Trying to find the measure of angle k. And I can do that. So here's what I know. So I've got a kite here. The tail of the kite and the head of the kite are always different angles. But the wing, left and right side, are congruent. So I know this is going to be 118. Right? So I've got 3 out of 4 angles. To find that fourth angle here, I know that the sum of the four angles is 360. So that's my strategy. 360 is going to equal 118 plus 118 again, right? Plus 74, plus the unknown angle, I'll call it x, okay? And sum those up, subtract from 360, and that is the value of x. So 118 and 118 would be 236, right? 236, and 236 plus 74 is 310. Subtracting that, 60, we end up with x equals 50. So, very, very predictable. What I mean by that is you're just adding the numbers up and subtracting it from 360 to find the missing angle. Now, these are really interesting questions because you have to use Pythagorean theorem to find the unknown side length, okay? So our job is to find the side length of the kite. And so I'll start with one example, and then you can work out the others on your own. So let's take a question 16. And we need to find the side length of the kite. So just want to make a quick point about the side length. If once I find segment KI, it's congruent to segment KE. Okay? And that's enough. And if I find the length of segment IT, then it's the same as segment ET. Make sense? All right, so let's do this. I see a right triangle here. Here's what I see. And I know it's a right triangle because the diagonals of a kite are perpendicular. So this angle here is a right angle. So let's label it. Distance here is 2. This is 4. So let's find the length of the hypotenuse, which is Pythagorean theorem, which is the length of KI, right? So that would be 2 squared. It's the leg plus the other leg is 4 squared. And that's going to equal the hypotenuse squared, which we call C squared. And I didn't show the initial step. That would be A squared plus B squared equals C squared. That's the Pythagorean theorem. It's always true for right triangles where the legs are A and B. A and B are interchangeable. But C is always the hypotenuse. The longest side of a right triangle is always opposite the 90-degree angle. And so I substitute, and I'd end up with 4 plus 16 equals C squared. Take the square root, end up with C squared equals 20. Again, I switch that around, personal preference, square root. And so C is going to equal square root of 4 times the square root of 5. Again, trying to simplify the radical. 4 times 5 is 20. See that? And radical 4 is 2. So the value of C is 2 square root 5. And that is the length, 2 square root 5. And this is also 2 square root 5. Right? Now, let's find the length of IT. Same method, different numbers. There's the triangle. I think I can get it. Let's see. There we go. So let's label it. Okay, so A, B, C, right? And I'm going to switch that around. C, B, A, B. And, ladies and gentlemen, that's the show. Good job. Way to work hard. And I know I went over lots of material, but you're completely capable of doing it all. Remember to check the website. On that website, I will have documents that show solutions to these questions. So please feel free to download those, print them out, and verify your work. Don't forget, the very last page, which is the last page on this document, you're required to put an X in the box that always has this given property. Okay, so what pairs of opposite sides are congruent? Rectangle, it's true, I put an X there. Rhombus, it's true. A square, it's true. It's not true for a kite. And it's not true for a trapezoid. So, again, you can use your activity portfolio packet. Those 6 activities do have some of these properties listed, and you can flip through and find these properties and verify that what you're marking as true is, in fact, true. Okie dokie. We'll talk to you later, and we'll see you on Monday. Bye-bye.